The Who spoke directly to us. Their music, their lyrics, the energy in their music. And they were, it just didn't get any bigger than The Who.
They were one of the biggest bands that everybody wanted to see. And when The Who was on the radio, you cranked your radio up and you drove around Finneytown and wanted everybody to know that you were listening to The Who.
It was just one of the go-to bands, like the Rolling Stones and The Who. I mean, you just had to, you know, put it in your repertoire of being there.
Right.
They're coming to Cincinnati, and the second we heard about it, we were just beyond excited.
Back in those days, we'd camp out. We got there at noon on the show day to get ready to go for the concert that was later on that evening.
It was huge, right?
It was big time.
Right.
And once we had those tickets, it was like gold. I felt like putting it in a safety deposit box. It was really, you know, the anticipation was amazing. I don't mind other guys
dancing with my girl. In those days, I'd put a show on sale, whatever it was, an arena, stadium, and it would be gone in minutes. The band were at their peak. The dynamic of the band was phenomenal. And so I think I'm safe in saying they were probably the biggest rock and roll band in the world at that time.
And our shows were long in those days. They were 2 hours, sometimes 2.5 hours. So you kind of get, it becomes like a whirlwind. You're kind of half in your body. It's a weird space. And then of course you push back into it the following day, and the following day, and the following day. So it becomes like a dream zone in a way. But that dreadful night of the 3rd of December became one of the worst dreams I've ever had in my life.
Something that I'll surely remember on my deathbed. You know, I've only maybe got 20, 30, 40 people that I remember who've passed in my life that I really care about. But, you know, the 11 from Cincinnati are part of that number.
We was up at the top and everybody was just pushing. I was on the bottom for about 20 minutes.
You was being stomped by for 20 minutes?
I was. I couldn't breathe. I thought I was dying. I lost my shoe. We were with these people right here, and he's dying.
What happened? Was this just too much pushing, or was it?
People would not stop. Yeah. They had intercoms going, move back, and nobody would move. Oh, it's a wreck in there.
People were just getting stamped on, and she was underneath, and I was trying to pull her out, and everybody was stamping on everybody.
You couldn't get up?
No, you couldn't get up, man. People were pushing all over everywhere.
Were they trying to control the crowd, the people, the organizers?
They couldn't.
On December 3rd, 1979, 11 people were killed at a Who concert outside the Riverfront Coliseum in downtown Cincinnati. An event that was supposed to bring excitement and joy to thousands of rock and roll fans turned into terror and panic. John! It made national headlines. 40 years later, survivors, victims' families, and band members talk about that night for the first time in depth. It has haunted many of them over the decades. One community lost 3 young lives.
My name is Matt Wergers, class of 1979, Finneytown High School. I don't know what overcome of everybody there. It was a free-for-all is basically what it was. There was a lot of people, I'm going to say juiced up, ready to go see this show.
There were 5 of us who went down together, and we always parked in the same spot.
Tickets sold weeks in advance for $10 a piece. Lines formed outside the venue hours before the show was slated to start at 8 p.m.
And there was just a lot of energy going on. And in the meantime, you had, you know, no pressure valve to open. You had the doors remained shut, but still, you know, it was a crowd that we were kind of familiar with.
Then fans heard music from inside the venue.
People thought the show was starting. It was a lot of fun up there at first, and then it just got into a... like a tidal wave. I was not as big as I am now, and I had my girlfriend with me, and we were literally being where my feet weren't even on the ground. I was grabbing her so tight that my feet and her feet were not on the ground because of the pressure of the people.
Survivor Matt Wergers focused on keeping his girlfriend safe.
Got out of the crowd when she couldn't breathe anymore. I was trying to pick her up so she could get air because she was shorter than me. And I got over to the wall, to the doors, and that's when a big surge came and pushed us once, and then it pushed us another time. And then the third or fourth time, the pressure was so bad that we literally went through one of them plate glass windows because of the pressure of the bodies pushing us against the glass. We had nowhere else to go, and the glass broke, and officers came right away right there, and I just did a body check on an officer, which I shouldn't have done, and we got into the venue. And several other 100 people came through that glass door also.
Thank God that glass door broke.
Oh, there could have been a lot more deaths there. I'm positive of that. If that wouldn't, that was like a dam breaking. If it didn't break the wall with the whole, you know, let some of the water out, or so to speak, the people to subside some of the pressure that was there.
And I gotta believe when that door broke, and all those people kind of pushed towards that side door, and a lot of people fell. I got to believe that's when, you know, that's when our friends and a lot of the 11, that's where they probably never got up again after that. And I remember I was with all of my strength from an 18-year-old, probably 145-pound guy, you know, trying to keep some room between my body and, you know, just keep some space.
Chaos ensued.
You know, this had been going on for maybe 15 minutes, maybe 10.
Yeah.
You know, a group was down in front. You couldn't really, you know, your vantage point until you got pushed right onto the pile. Right. And you couldn't really tell what was going on. Or how, you know, you would think you could get up, but there was no space to get up, except for standing on other people and then, right, you know, you get knocked back down again. And so it was getting pretty chaotic, pretty scary.
At one point, Tammy Hartfales fell to the ground. Her friend Doug picked her and others up.
And Doug, who, well, thank God he was really tall, he just kind of like grabbed me.
Doug, I don't know, he was trying to pull some guy out that was on the bottom of the pile, and his head was right by our feet, and he was completely blue colored. He was pretty much gone at that moment. And people were yelling, you know, back up, but people, 10 people back, you know, first you didn't know what was going on.
Right.
And it was impossible to back up because it was that congested and tight. Yeah.
And at that point, the whole crowd surged that way. And that, a lot of people, from what I saw, went down at that point. And I have to believe, you know, I've thought, I mean, you know, 40 years of thinking about this and turning it over. And you know, in a way, the way it happened, the way the circumstances surrounding it, I still haven't completely assimilated what happened that night. My friend is there 1 minute and I never see him again.
That was one of the most traumatic times of my life, I would think. Waking up and hearing your mom say your friend's dead.
There was no reason to suspect that this was dangerous. You know, your children are supposed to be safe at one of those events, and that's, you know, why did this have to happen?
I was watching television, and I saw what was going on, and of course I was alert to that, whatever they were showing, and I saw them carrying a kid out of the front, and I said, those are Stephen's shoes. And when he got home, when my husband got home, I told him, and he said, no, you're just jumping to conclusions. And that whole night, I didn't sleep, of course, because he didn't come home. His friends came home without him and said they couldn't find him. And we called the morgue. We described him. We said he had on braces. Do you have a kid with blondish hair and braces? No, we don't have one. Well, then Joe Heltman, who lived across the street, and he was Stephen's best friend of the whole group, he and his sister Barbara went down to the morgue. He was the one that Stephen was supposed to ride home with. And they identified him there and came back at 5 a.m. and told us.
My friends started to gather there, and eventually we had everybody that we went down there with, just about, I think. And anybody asked, has anybody seen Steve? And nobody had seen him, and we figured he was just, you know, he went off with somebody else, you know.
Stephen Preston was 19 years old and had just graduated from Finneytown High School.
Everybody called him Pips. Pips was a nickname that was given to him pretty early because of his appearance. He was very slight in appearance, you know, smallish with long, sort of straw color hair, bright eyes, freckles. And somebody started calling him, in our group, started calling him Pippi Longstockings, which shortened up to Pips.
Stephen was in the middle of braces. He had an orthodontic appointment the morning of the WHO. I had talked with him that night when he came in, and I said, I want you to attend your appointment tomorrow morning. And he said, I'm not going. And I said, what do you mean you're not going? And he said, because I want to be first for the festival seating. And that was it. That was the last time I talked to him.
Oh, for months, how many months? She, every day, mm-hmm. I can't wait till the WHO concert. Mm-hmm. And we were like, oh.
Jackie Eckerly was 15 years old. She didn't come home after the show.
I called the morgue and described Jackie, and they said, no, we don't have anyone like that here. So I said, oh, okay. And I told my mom, I said, well, I'm just gonna go back home for a while. If you need me, call me. And as I was going, their driveway was long off the road on the bend on Seymour. And I was going up the hill, and I saw a police cruiser slowly going as if looking for a house. And so I stopped and said, are you looking for an address? And they said, yes, and it was ours. So they took me down to the morgue, and I identified her. And then I had to call home, and then I came home. They brought me home. And that must have been maybe 2 a.m. It was in the night. It was late.
Jackie went with Karen Morrison, Sandy Cottle, which was our neighbor right next door, and another girl that I don't know her name. And they all rode down together because they wanted to go early to get in line, to get a good seat. But at some point, they got split up.
Karen Morrison was also just 15.
The WHO concert was her first concert. She was a month shy of being 16. She never got to get her driver's license. She never got to vote. She never got to graduate from high school. She never got to go to her prom. She was going to be going to a Christmas dance, and she was buried in the dress that she bought to wear to the Christmas dance. It was just devastating. And the devastation didn't stop there. It didn't stop with the sudden knowledge that their daughter was dead. My uncle, who's 91 years old, still grieves.
The community of Wyoming, which borders Finneytown, was also affected.
My brother Peter was one of the 11. I mean, every time I see those pictures of the shoes laying out there and stuff, you know, it's like, you know, which one of those is his? And, you know, those are not easy pictures to look at.
Peter Bobes was 18 years old. He went alone to the show and planned to meet friends.
It was bad weather, cold weather. You know, everybody was, you know, trying to get in, wanted to get in. Nobody expects to go to a concert and expects to die.
I think I was a little shocked how could it, and then questioning how could it all be all from our school, that many from our school, the percentage, and I'm trying to do my math, the percentage, like, that's a big chunk of the people, you know, and they're all so young, and, you know, what do you say to people when you go to school? Well, you know, how do you react? Right. You know, I'm 17 years old. I didn't know how to act or react.
Sadly and tragically, this, what happened that night, changed us all. It changed everything. We were carefree, you know, partying, a bunch of kids who threw caution to the wind quite a bit, lived somewhat dangerously at times. That night, as we were approaching our 20s, early 20s, late teens, it just kind of changed everything.
Peter Bose, Karen Morrison, Jacqueline Eckerly, Teva Ladd, David Joseph Heck, Stephen Preston, Brian Wagner, Walter Adams Jr., James Wormuth, Connie Sue Burns, Philip Snyder.
From what I understand of the situation at the Coliseum is that the unfortunate deaths that took place were due to some sort of trauma of some kind of activity down there. It does not appear to be drug-related deaths. I want the community to understand that and not to worry that there's something out there going to poison or harm their children, friends, or relatives. It appears that most of what has happened has been due to trauma, and I want to make that very clear.
Thousands of people had no idea what was going on outside of the Coliseum, and those who witnessed the mayhem were in shock.
At that time, the emergency vehicles were already driving onto the plaza. Saw the body bags were being zipped up. You know, we weren't that
purses,
far away from
coats, shoes.
Right, the pile of all the clothing.
All over.
I think we were in a little bit of shock. The concert, I couldn't remember what songs they played, nothing. It was a blur.
It was a blur.
It's the first concert I've ever been to. I was waiting for it to end, if that makes any sense. I just wanted to get out. And I don't know why we just didn't get up and leave.
11 people died and dozens were injured, but the show continued.
I think it would have been an absolute disaster to try and shut it down.
What triggered the chaos? Festival seating was a major factor.
Historically, festival seating drew people very early in the day because festival seating is a first come, first serve. You know, those in the door get the best seats in the house or get right in front of the stage.
People were anxious to see the band and escape the cold.
But on this particular night, at 1:30 in the afternoon, people had started to gather for an 8 o'clock concert. We actually were asked to come earlier. By 3 o'clock, there were probably 500 people waiting to get in. And that grew exponentially. By 5 o'clock, we estimated probably 2,000 people waiting to get in.
Just by that one set of doors, right?
Just by the main entrance doors. And that continued to grow. The doors were supposed to open at 6:30 p.m. And our estimate at 6:30 p.m. were 12,000 people were waiting to get in. That was unbelievable. We'd never, ever experienced that before.
Over the years, I've heard several explanations, and the one that keeps coming up is that they heard the Who doing a sound check. The audience outside lining up in the cold, and they heard the Who doing the sound check. They thought that that was them on stage, and so they crashed the doors. But none of this seemed to correlate for me, because one, we didn't do sound checks so much in those days, and two, if we did, it would have been like 4:30 in the afternoon. I went back and checked. We didn't have a support act. What we had was a 10-minute trailer of the movie Quadrophenia, and we ran that before the Who went on stage, and that trailer acted as a support band. So on giving this a lot of thought, I'm sure that what the audience, the fans heard while they were queuing up was the film crew checking that trailer to make sure that it was running okay. And of course, if the audience heard that, if the fans heard that from outside, they did hear the Who, of course. It was Who music. So that's the only explanation that's really rung true with me.
Police reports show that only a few doors were used to filter more than 18,000 people inside the venue. It's an image Stephen Preston's stepfather has replayed over and over again in his mind for years.
There was so much pressure. There were 18,000 kids, and they were essentially funneled across this walkway that led to the Coliseum, and then it was focused down to these two turnstiles. And 18,000 kids were supposed to go through two turnstiles and show a ticket at a Who concert, as if they're going to do that in an orderly manner. So by the time that the kids had heard the band warming up and they knew it was getting late, and the crowd at the back was getting antsy, the kids that were at the front were just mashed up against the glass. They were probably not even touching the ground from all the pressure of 18,000 people behind them. The first reports about there being a problem. So, you know, there were a few minutes after that, like 15, before the doors were opened, and that would certainly have been long enough. The mental image of that moment. Yeah, it was hard. Just imagining being there.
Don't imagine. I think Jackie went down in front of him, and he went down to help her up and never made it up, because the two of them died right together, one on top of the other.
Even though it was cold, I was sweating profusely just trying to physically stay upright. Because it was, the way you can describe it is like when you're in the ocean and a wave grabs you and it pushes you in and sucks you back, you know? That's what it was. You could literally see bodies doing this and this.
More people came right in. We got closer and closer to the door because right. People were moving forward, anxious to get in. Because it was festival seating, so of course you want to be there first, get in, get great seats.
Right, there's a bunch of media about that too, you know, trampled like we were animals, right. You know, which wasn't the case at all.
Yeah.
Right.
So trampled shouldn't have been a word they used.
No, shouldn't have been.
I literally seen people being pushed up in the air and walking on people into the door, and a guy grabbing on the awning before the door and swinging himself into the building. I'm sorry.
What just happened there?
Goosebumps. Like I fell in a cold lake. Because it's a very traumatic time of my life. I don't think the people of Cincinnati know the depth of us kids that were there. You know, I was 18 years old, and seeing what we saw, I know our parents and our parents before that, you know, were in wars and stuff. And that's the only way I could probably describe what I saw there as something so horrific that was instilled in my mind for the rest of my life.
I was the chief paramedic for National Medic Service the night of the Who concert, December 3rd, 1979. Looking at my uniform from that night.
Guy Ninio was one of the first on the scene.
I don't know if you've seen any pictures of the clothing stacks that were at the side of each door that had been opened. When these people came through that door, it was like they're being put through a hamburger masher, you know. Literally, and their clothes are being peeled off of them as they're coming through the door. I'm Jewish, and it was reminiscent of the pictures of Auschwitz, where all the camp victims had tall stacks of clothing everywhere. and that's what it was like.
Nobody was prepared for what happened. I mean, we had every rescue unit, EMT, paramedic unit in the city was at the Coliseum. I mean, we ended up, 11 people died, 25 were transported to the hospital, and we probably had another 50 to 75 that were treated at the scene.
I just did the best I could with what I had.
It hits me. You were 22. You were not much older in some cases.
And some of the victims. That's right. But life goes on. And I think that, you know, there's still a great deal of the walking wounded out there.
The victims' cause of deaths were the same.
Chest compression.
Yeah.
Everybody was just squeezed to death. Can't
Asphyxiation.
Breathe.
Asphyxiation.
Yeah. I suspect that they were all gone before the doors were opened.
The coroner's report said it was asphyxiation. And that's all it said, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much as far as I know how everybody died. People were not crushed.
She didn't get to enjoy her life. And because of that, her parents didn't get to enjoy their life. Christmas was coming. They decided not to have Christmas and never did again.
I think what was very hard, it was such a freak accident that was hard to digest. It was hard to understand that you could be waiting in line for a concert and die.
Several victims' families filed a joint lawsuit. Festival seating was banned in Cincinnati for 25 years as a result.
You know, the whole festival seating and what happened, it didn't just change here in Cincinnati. It's spread across the country.
It's a big deal, right? It was on the news, I mean, months, you know, all this was going on.
But it was brought back in 2009 at U.S. Bank Arena, formerly known as Riverfront Coliseum.
25 years later, they reversed themselves. And I wrote multiple letters. I was retired from Cincinnati Police Department at the time, recounting what the issues with festival seating were, but they were pretty much ignored.
And with assigned seating, you know, it may be difficult for people to get good seats all the time, but I can tell you it's safer. I can tell you what the most important thing is, and that's that your kid's gonna come home that night from a general admission show.
December 3rd, 1979, forever linked 11 people from Cincinnati to British rock stars. But The Who never returned to Cincinnati to perform. The incident rattled Finneytown, home to Karen, Jackie, and Stephen for decades. A group wanted to make sure the victims would never be forgotten. They formed a memorial at Finneytown High School called PEM. PEM represents the first letter in each last name of the victims.
We went to the three families, the Prestons, the Eckerleys, and the Morrisons, who have been involved with the PEM Memorial since day one of the first memorial, and asked them to provide personal items from each of the three kids that we could put in the case, again, to make the kids today understand that these were just three kids.
So what they've done is created three scholarships, again, in the three Finneytown students' names, and they award three scholarships each year to a graduating senior who's going to be pursuing something in the arts. Something bad has been turned into something good.
Look what is happening because of Jackie and her friends. Look at the good that's happening here and the scholarships that are being given out. So it was senseless, yes, but it's doing good things.
In 2018, Roger Daltrey quietly met with the group to pay respect to survivors and victims' families. It was his first time back in the Cincinnati area since 1979.
Yeah, Roger, this is the case that the band funded for us.
Hello, Tyrus, how young?
15.
Oh.
For many, it was a moment of healing.
Thank you. But it was just so important that Roger even came, spent the time to come to Cincinnati to visit the families. It was just so amazingly kind of him.
If there's anything that came close to bringing things full circle, it was that.
I really like what Roger Daltrey did for our school, to come and say his part and his piece and to be part of our PEM program that we do every year. That gives us a lot of peace.
Since that night in 1979, The Who has never talked in depth about what happened. Until now.
Oh God, it was such a whirlwind period. I mean, we were kind of making it up as we went along, pushed and pulled in every direction by everybody. It was a very strange period. And of course, it was just after we lost Keith Moon that we went back on the road possibly too quickly. We filled the space with a new drummer, tried to reform what we had, made a record, which was a good record, I think it was a good record, but then went out to play it, and we were a wounded animal, I have to say that. We weren't playing at our best. Pete was having, you know, kind of problems with substances, and I think it was all down to the grief of losing Keith. So it was a very traumatic time for us anyway, as a band. And then that dreadful night, that December the 3rd in Cincinnati, was like, ugh. It was like, I can't tell you, it was like being just hit with a bat, like coming off stage, and you think you've done a wonderful show. And it was a great show. It was one of the best shows we played on the whole tour. The crowd were incredible. And then we were told what had happened before the show had started. And that was like being whacked with a baseball bat around the head. It was just a shock. And I think we did the rest of the tour without really talking to hardly anybody, in total silence. We hardly spoke to each other. We never spoke on stage. We just played our music. We just lost ourselves in our music. It was kind of weird. And it just didn't feel any way to make it right. It was just one of those, that period of being away through that 3 weeks of that tour after the 3rd of December was the longest 3 weeks of my life, I think.
That date sticks with you, doesn't it? You know that date.
Well, it's always stuck with me. You know, it did till I went to Finneytown last year. And I'm really glad I did, and saw the wonderful work that they do there with their scholarships for the three people they lost at that school. And you have to go forward, and that released a lot for me. And I know it did for our manager. I know it did for Bill Kirbishley, because I did have the chance to thank him in front of the people and parents of who lost. So that helped a lot for us. But the scars are still there. The scars will never go away. They never do, that kind of grief, you know. I think it's like the scars of someone coming home from a war zone. You know, they just sit with you.
But you've never done an interview about it.
No, well, we were never given the opportunity, because the next thing we knew, we had lawyers on our back. And we were called to a we called back to Cincinnati to meet a load of lawyers who were trying to accuse us that it was all our fault, which was kind of a bit of a shock to the system. But equally, was it our fault? I don't know. I don't think it was. But he kind of made the statement, we have to take some responsibility. But I must admit, in my head, I never ever felt any. We just happened to be the band that were playing there that night that this happened on the way into a show. Why it happened, who knows? Only the people on the door will know that.
There's a chip off my soul that I left in Cincinnati.
It was Bill Kerbishley's decision for the band to continue playing.
I can well remember them going on stage, and they were maybe like about the second number in. And Larry Maggie came to me and he said that there was a problem up on the plaza level, and he thought it was the result of bad drugs. So I said, what? So he said, yeah, he said, and he said, it's looking really serious. I said, let's go. So I went up to the plaza level with him. And when I got there, it was awful, it was horrific. I mean, there were shoes and clothing everywhere. And the medical teams were working on a lot of the injured in an effort to obviously save them. And I could see for sure that there were a couple that had passed away. And in talking, it was crazy as well. I mean, the whole thing that was going on, there was nobody really in my mind that was in direct control. But for me, the first responders, the medical teams, were so engrossed in what they were doing that I don't know who was in control, but I know that a fire marshal came to me and said they were talking about stopping the show, and I said, that's crazy. You cannot, and I'm not gonna allow you to stop the show. I don't know how I would have stopped them, but I said, if you stop the show, I think you'll have more problems on the arena floor. You could have more people being hurt, for sure. And if they came back through this area, the medical teams are never going to be able to cope with what they're doing. And if keeping my band on stage saves even one life, to me, that's what it's about. It's really, really important. And then another fire marshal came up to me and he said, he's absolutely right. And he concurred with me. And he said, you know, we've got to be doing what we're doing now. We've got to clear this. So the band carried on stage. I stayed up there for quite a while. I then went back down. And when the band actually came off at the end of their set, I said to them, look, I got them very quickly. And I said, look, go back, only do two songs. We've got a real serious problem. I'll explain afterwards. I think they sensed that it was something really serious, you know, by my tone and everything and demeanor, that there was something serious. So they went back on, played the two songs, came off. I took them into the dressing room and I told them. At that time, I didn't know that there actually were 11 youngsters that had died, but I did know there were deaths. And obviously it affected them greatly, you know. It shook them a lot. And they then started to have a discussion with me about what we should do about the next day, what we should do about the next shows, etc. And I said to them, look, I really felt that this was a little bit like being in a plane disaster and then never getting back on a plane again, you know, fear of flying. So I really felt that if they didn't play another concert, they may never play again.
I remember feeling good about the show and really good about it. And came off stage and Bill Kirbishley came in and said, I've got some really bad news. Tertullian started to explain it to us. And I went through two phases, you know. One was, of course, tremendous upset and concern, but the other was incredible anger that we had been performing while this was going on. I couldn't really castigate our manager for allowing the concert to go on if I hadn't seen that, because his argument was, Pete, you didn't see what I saw. So he went out there and he saw it. So I had to see it myself in order to have build up an argument for him to say, well, okay, now I understand your decision. I still don't agree with it. I don't think we should have performed until it had been sorted out. But the main thing, as I said earlier, I don't think we should have left. You know, we could have postponed Buffalo. We should have stayed in the city at least for 3 days. We should have just stayed there for a while, you know, made it clear that we were there and we were mourning and we were part of the process of trying to work out what had happened. And that we were able to have this conversation then. I think one of the things we were concerned about is it probably would have taken me 2 days to sober up.
When 9 people died at a Pearl Jam concert in 2000, Pete Townshend contacted Eddie Vedder.
My immediate reaction, as I said, was to get Eddie on the phone and to tell him to stay. Just to stay there. Not to leave, just to stay. Because then he could get a sense, they could get a sense of what it was that was right to do next. Ran away is what we did. I'm sorry, but that's what happened. We ran away. You know, one of the reasons maybe why the scar has been tricky is because, wow, you know, this is the first conversation in depth that we've had about this ever. So, you know, maybe now the scar will heal a little bit. You know, but I think it requires us to go back and do a show there. I hadn't realized that we just haven't done it.
Are you saying to me this is the first in-depth conversation you've had about this?
Yeah. The first dedicated conversation about the accident. Yeah. I'm still very traumatized by it. It's a weird thing to have in your life. It's a weird thing to have in your autobiography that, you know, 11 kids died at one of your concerts. It's a strange, disturbing, heavy load to carry. And I have to say, you know, we need to go back to Cincinnati. You know, we do as soon as we can. And I think, I spoke to Bill about this the other day and he brought it up and I said, come on, Bill, let's just do it. You know, let's just do it. Let's do the whole show for the endowment fund. Let's just go and do it. You know, it's nothing like it is ever going to happen again. And it would be such a joyous occasion for us and such a healing thing, I think.
Because I'd have no objection to going back. Not at all.
Is it time to come back? Play again since
then? Okay. If they said to me they wanted to go back, I would do that in a heartbeat. I haven't put it to them because I didn't want them to think that I was pushing them into doing it for any other reason that they want to do it. And I didn't want them to think that I had another agenda, which I don't have. But if they wanted to go back, I would be totally 100% behind it. 110% behind it.
Well, Pete says you're doing it.
Did he? Well, if he said that, I'll do it.
You might heal a little bit too.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I think I would. It's very difficult, isn't it? Revisiting something that's been a trauma. Very difficult, but I could go back to the city, but I don't think I could go back to that venue. I saw enough that night that I don't want to revisit. But to see the people of Cincinnati and maybe have some of the people, those that are still around, to attend the concert would be something really fantastic, I think, you know.
They were the backdrop to my youth in a lot of ways.
I mean, a Who song comes on, you know, from that first chord. It's it, and I kind of perk up. Car volume goes up.
Energy level.
Yeah, I have my Sirius radio, and you have the scroll there of who's playing. Oh, I'll switch if I see Who.
Right.
Yeah. Still listen to them, I will.
Right.
Forever.
But I never did think it was the Who's fault, because the Who were doing a gig. They go from town to town, they show up, they do their job.
But some of the most famous people in the world, but they also have hearts and souls, and, you know, 40 years, you know, they've been feeling this too, I'm certain.
But I think it would go a real long way for them to set it aside, come here and give some closure to those in need. And that would be the one big takeaway I want from all of this, is that somebody listened to this. Somebody care about this. The walking wounded will forever be wounded until somebody puts a patch over it.
I don't think they'll ever come back to Cincinnati.
I think it would be very cathartic for the band to play in Cincinnati again. I think it would allow them to move past the memories and create new memories.